We'd like to welcome everybody to our spring education event through the Ontario chapter PPPC. Really excited to have Marilyn Barefoot here today, who came highly recommended from many, many sources. She has a lot of great experience speaking within our industry, so has a really good knowledge of what we do on a daily basis. And today she's going to be talking about presentation skills and storytelling, which I think applies to everything we do on a daily basis. Before we get started, I did want to give mention and thanks to people who put time and effort into organizing the event, specifically Scott Waters from Waters Marketing, who helped organize the event, and also to the board of directors for the Ontario chapter who volunteer, who are here today with us, including, I'm going to see where everybody is, Jessica's in here, Jessica DeMel from ESP, Carrie Petrella from the branding company, who else is here? Victoria's gone. Sandra Harsar from Bright Ideas is in the back, also from our national board. So thank you everyone for all of your great efforts and your time. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Marilyn. And please stay behind at the end because we are going to be doing a draw for the people who brought a buddy so they can win some money. Thank you very much for your time, everyone. Marilyn.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. I feel like I'm in church, right? There's nobody down in the front row. It is so lovely to be here. Thank you for asking me to join you today. If I am way too loud, somebody just like put up their hand because we can adjust this with the amazing technology we have in the background. Today is all about stories and presentations. I'm an ad agency brat. We were just talking about how many years I spent in the business. As an advertising agency brat, I would like to share one story with you to kick off. The biggest agency I ever worked for in my entire career was BBDO, downtown, Young and Bloor. January the 5th was my first day. I had spent hours the night before picking out the right shoes, the right everything. I'm gonna be a big advertising executive. So I arrive early, right at the corner of Young and Bloor, and they've given me some pass cards, probably five. I don't know, like, I'm in a huge high-rise building. I don't know which pass card or what elevator, and people are, I finally find my way to the right elevator using the right pass card to get to my little rabbit warren of an office, and I sit down. Onboarding was not a skill of BBDO. There was like nothing there. There was nobody there. There was just, what do you do? I didn't even know how to turn on the computer. So I just kind of waited, because if I turned on the computer and did something wrong, God help me. The phone rings. It's a display phone. So I see the name on the phone is Jerry Fraccione. He's the president. I think, oh, how lovely. The president is actually calling me to welcome me to the agency. Marilyn Barefoot speaking. Get up here. I thought, I've been here all of like 15 seconds. The guy doesn't sound very friendly, but maybe that's just his telephone voice. So I go and find all my little cards to find my way to the 32nd floor where Jerry Fraccione's big office is. Now, when you get to the 32nd floor at BBDO, it's massive. And I didn't know where the hell I was going. I'd been there 15 seconds. It wasn't hard to figure it out because Jerry smoked. Jerry had a huge office and a bathroom. So Jerry figured that people didn't know that he smoked because he would find a fan in his bathroom and stand underneath it and smoke. Didn't work so well. So as soon as you got off the elevator, you could find your way to Jerry's office without too much trouble. I got there and he sat me down at this boardroom table that was about as large as this room and said, not welcome, not how are you, not we're glad to have you. We are shortlisted for the biggest pitch in Canadian advertising history, and we are pitching next Friday. I was like, great. Congratulations. We need you to stand up and do part of that pitch. The pitch is 90 minutes. You will do 20 minutes, and it is for Rogers Communications. The size of the prize, $123 million. Okay. I didn't exactly know what to say, except, what would you like me to talk about for 20 minutes? You will be talking about the Rogers brand. Okay. So you better hurry up, get down to your office, and get working. So I went down to my office, and it didn't take long for the IT people to show up, show me how to use my computer and the phone and the computers, and everything started going. Well, for the next 7 days, as we got ready for the pitch with Rogers Communications, it was nuts. Rehearsals and people being flown in as presentation coaches from all over the world, consultants, fresh flowers, sushi chefs, red carpets. I mean, $123 million. They were laying it all on the line. We rehearsed, we rehearsed. We had 90 minutes. Apparently, according to what we were told, by Ted Rogers, God rest his soul, who was going to be on the selection committee, that at the 90-minute mark, Ted would stand. And if you said one single word after he stood up, you were off the list. That's it. Canceled. Goodbye. I don't know why, but that's the rule. The day arrives. It's a Friday afternoon. This huge executive bus pulls up in front of BBDO at Young & Bloor. We have people in the lobby to greet these people. We have red carpets. We have fresh flowers. We have elevator people ready to get them to the 32nd floor. They get up there. It doesn't smell like cigarettes anymore. We even had Jerry's office fumigated. We had thought of everything. Along the back of the boardroom, we had the table where all of the selection committee sat, and we knew exactly where Ted had to sit because we knew that he was deaf in the left ear. We'd thought of everything. So we start. Comes time for me. I stand up and I said, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to talk to you about the Rogers brand. And I get about three sentences into my presentation. Ted stands up. I froze. I'm like, okay, we're like 17 minutes into this. There's no way it's 90 minutes. But I didn't want to say anything. Can I make you Ted? Just as a marker. Yeah, you don't have to do a damn thing. You just have to be my visual marker. He said to me, what the hell do you know about our brand? Now, you can see Jerry, the president, purple. Great. The only question that's been asked, coming from the founder, Ted Rogers, to the chick who's been at the agency for 5 days. I looked at him and I said, Ted, with all due respect, we know absolutely nothing about the Rogers brand. At this point, Jerry Fraccioni was like ready to phone HR and go fire her butt now. So Ted, could I tell you a little story? He said, yeah. So here's the story that I told in that presentation. I'd been hired by Vickers and Benson Advertising to work on the McDonald's restaurant account. It was my first day on the business. I was very excited, all dressed. There early, fantastic. I arrive at the reception desk and say, hi, I'm Marilyn Barefoot. I'm here to work on the McDonald's restaurant business. Good morning, Marilyn. This was Joan. Joan was about 150 years old and had been with the agency since it was founded. I said, good morning. She had a name plaque. It said Joan. So I said, good morning, Joan.
They're waiting for you up the street.
Joan, am I in the wrong building? I'm here. I'm here to work on the McDonald's business at Vickers Events and Advertising.
They're waiting for you up the street.
I said, where up the street?
At McDonald's.
I'm like, wait. I'm not here to work at McDonald's. I'm the new account manager on the McDonald's business.
George Cohan and Ronald McDonald are waiting for you.
I said, why?
Because George Cohan believes that nobody works on his business who doesn't work in the restaurant for 2 weeks first.
So out from underneath her desk, she produces a big red trainee apron and a trainee button that was like the size of a dinner plate. And in my perfect little outfit, I thought, I walked up the street to McDonald's. And there they were, literally, George Cohan and Ronald McDonald, who gave me a round of applause. Those 2 weeks, Ted, were the toughest 2 weeks of my life. They put me on the fry station first. I spent most of the morning on my butt in my brand new little shoes that hadn't been scuffed enough. I learned more in those 2 weeks about the brand McDonald's than I ever could have learned anywhere else. So when I say to you in this pitch, we don't know anything about the Rogers brand, it's because we don't know the Rogers brand because we haven't lived it. We're going to get on your trucks. We're going to work in your call centers. We're going to work on your phones. We're going to go and install services. We're going to work in your retail stores. We're going to know it inside and out. And when we do, I'll be able to say, yes, I can talk to you about your brand. Because yes, I've walked a mile in Ronald McDonald's shoes, or yours to be specific. He was happy. I off-roaded with an answer. It worked. The president's blood pressure started to go down. The next guy stood up and began his presentation. And in the middle of the presentation, in front of the windows of the 32nd floor glass boardroom, flew a blimp. The tail banner on the blimp said, "Are you bored yet?" Hired by the competing agency, who knew where we were, when we were presenting, and they hired a blimp. Yeah, thank God it wasn't me on my feet at the time that that happened. We lost the pitch to Rogers Communications. Might have had a lot to do with the blimp, because as the selection committee was leaving our office, the guys were down on the street with little baby blimps with their business card attached to them from the president of their agency, handing them out to everybody on the selection committee, and they won. The purpose of that was to show you, that was actually a story within a story, as you found, because we were talking about the pitch and you were playing Ted for me, so thank you. And embedded in that was another story. Did you feel it? Could you see it? We're going to come back and talk about why. I was telling somebody this story this morning. We were just talking about, people may forget who you are and your name, but the story that is attached to you will remain with you always. Let's just do a little bit of something. First of all, does everybody at the tables know each other? Do we need to do a hey, how are you, meet and greet? Do you guys know each other? Yes, no, have you said hello? Nobody knows each other, you're okay? You're okay. All right, so you guys, over here, Tammy, could I ask you to stand and come and join these two people over here, because it feels like kind of Noah's Ark is happening in the front row here, and we don't want that. On your tables, there are four colors of index cards. The ones I want you to focus on right now is I want everyone to please get one pink, one green, and one yellow in front of you. And the blue ones we'll keep for another time. So if you could just put, thank you guys, if you could put the pink one in front of you, and there are pens on the table, Or you can use your crayons that are also on the table. I would like you personally to complete this sentence for me, please. I love presenting because. You're on pink. Pink, the color of the heart, the color of love. Pink. With crayons if you want. They've also given you some pens. Compliments of the establishment. I love presenting because. Don't overthink anything. Simply just go with your first gut reaction. This would be great. I love presenting because. We could have a teeny tiny little bit of iPod music while this is going on, my dear, if you don't mind, just to fill up the echoing sound of my voice in the room. First reaction, best reaction, only reaction, that's all I want to hear. Now, if you could please pick up the green card. The green, thanks. The green card is hate. Go a little lighter on the music, thank you. Perfect. I hate presenting because. Hate is a big word. It's a strong word, but I meet a lot of people who use it when it comes to presenting. If you don't hate it, don't put anything down. If you absolutely do not dislike it in any way, leave it blank. Next, I'm gonna grab the handheld mic from you. Thanks. Thank you. Yellow card, please. The yellow card is the last card we're gonna fill out, and that one is to be, I fear presenting because. Now, hate and fear can walk hand in hand sometimes, but they are different emotions. So I fear presenting because. So pink is love, green is hate, yellow is fear. Okay, thank you for the music. Now, let us go to the pink card. If you would like to stand up and share what you wrote on your pink card, please do so. Just stand up for me if you would like to tell the world in this room, why do you love presenting? Or I'm gonna need to start volunteering people. Yay! I think we need a big round of applause. Yay, Patty! Here's the mic. You need the mic close to your mouth. I'm gonna hand you that. Tell us why you love it. Closer? That's it.
I love presenting because I love sharing.
Excellent! That's fantastic. Yes, round of applause, Patty. Yes, my dear. Nobody has name tags, so just everybody is my dear. Close up to your mouth.
I love presenting because I enjoy talking with people.
Fantastic. Enjoy talking with people. Let's have two more. Yes, my dear.
It's kind of similar. I love
presenting. You're going to stand up for me. I make people do that. Okay. It works an appetite up for the snacks later. It's
beautiful.
Fantastic.
It's similar to yours. I love presenting because it allows me to connect to people.
Beautiful. Paul. What did you say?
I really enjoy presenting because I like the interaction with everyone in the room.
Fantastic. Okay, round of applause for the love cards. Who'd like to talk about the green hate cards? Somebody got a real hate for presenting that they would like to share? Anyone? Fantastic. I love it when we have a participant. You can just stand for the whole time. It would be great.
I never participate in these things. So.
Oh, well, thank you for making an exception for us today, then.
Just kidding. I hate presenting because a great presentation takes time and energy to make.
Yeah, something we don't have a lot of.
And sometimes I don't want to do it. But anyways.
Alrighty. That is a very honest share. I love it. Curtis, on your feet for me, please.
I hate presenting because it's stressful.
Bingo. I think everybody in the room could potentially, except you, my dear. Yes, my dear. Could you stand up for me, please, and into the mic, tell us why you hate presenting.
Okay, I love presenting, but I hate presenting when people sit on their cell phones and don't pay attention.
One more hate card. Any more? One more hate card from coming to this table. Thank you, Kate.
I hate presenting because of the time and resource commitment, which usually involves Toronto traffic, so.
Anything that has Toronto traffic in it. Round of applause for the hate presenting cards. Okay, and lastly, we're gonna go to fear. Does anyone fear it? If you fear it and you would like to share that fear, you have something written on your yellow card. Would you like to tell us what it is? It looks quite long and involved, so I'm interested. Oh, good.
I fear presenting because I feel like I might forget what I am trying to say.
Forget your points, your slides, your just, okay. There's lots of people who could probably relate to that. Carol, why do you fear presenting?
Inadequate research.
Inadequate research. Somebody might go, wait a second, you're wrong. And then you feel like a fool in front of the rest of the world. One more fear card. Who's got a fear card?
I was the same as Carol. I just have unknown elements when you're unprepared for a random question.
Fantastic. Round of applause for the fear cards. We can now put those cards just to the side. And we're going to throw up the screen. And leave the lights up. Because I think I want to make sure that we're ready to go. So the first part of this is you suck at PowerPoint. This is going to run very quickly because the focus of what we really want to do together today is about stories and how we can use them in business to be impactful and powerful. I would like people to wave hands in the air, stand up, do whatever you feel like doing. If you see or recognize something in here that has happened either to you personally or you've been in the audience when something like this has potentially happened. So, 350 PowerPoint presentations are given every second around the world, and about 99% of them suck. But you know what? It's not the PowerPoint that sucks. It's the presenter. It's you, sorry to say. Because you're not using it properly. We are not using these things properly. Your slides are an aid, not a crutch. I'll interject a story, just because we weave them. Whirlpool, Benton Harbor, Michigan. I wasn't there, I just heard the story. Guy stood up, was giving a presentation. Literally giving a presentation by reading his slides with his back to the audience. Anyone gone through that in their entire life before? Seen that? Been there, done that? Yes? Somebody in the audience stood up and said, is this what you're gonna do for the next hour and a half? You're gonna stand there and read the slides to me? And the guy went, uh-huh. I said, great, bye. Email it to me, I'm getting on an earlier plane. Because we are going to learn, make sure I got this right, yes. We're going to learn some design mistakes that I see every day and I think you see every day, just for you to be aware of before we jump into storytelling. So here's five shocking design mistakes you need to avoid. Number one, too much information. Nobody needs to write a thing down, by the way. I forgot to tell you that. If anybody wants a soft copy of this, I've got a bowl. You can throw me a business card. So feel free to take notes if you want to, but I'm also happy to share this. We don't need to vomit every single piece of information on the slide. First of all, nobody can read it. And second of all, here's the fear. I might forget something. Because there's so much up there, people have to stand and read it because they're worried that they're going to forget some of that information. If you're going to put word for word what you're going to say on your screen, sit down. Because you're basically standing up reading a document, right? You are not giving a document, you're giving a presentation. The eyes, the people's attention in the room should be on you, not up there. Only 1 point per slide. We don't need to have flying bullets. We don't have to have multiple bullets, because your audience is then reading rather than listening to you, getting ahead of you, and you're standing there. Did I remember all of them? And if you miss one, the audience read it and they didn't hear you say it, and now you're screwed. And now you're nervous, and now you've got hives going up your neck and all over your face. Keep it relevant. It has to flow together. The great Jerry Fraccione in the BBDO world. The pitch decks, at 11 o'clock at night, somebody would send you a slide, and somebody else would send you a slide, and somebody else would send you a slide. And it looked like a dog's breakfast, because they came from all different parts of the world and all different parts of the agency. Nothing flowed relevantly together. I think some people get nervous. Ah, they're not going to take me seriously. They won't believe what I have to say. So they put a lot of junk up on the screen to make them feel like, I actually know what I'm talking about. Wrong. If you need to prove that you actually know what you're talking about, leave them a handout. Leave them a leave behind. Do something that says, yeah, if you want to challenge my numbers, here you go. But they don't need to be up here. Do the hard work for your audience. In other words, if you want them to focus on two numbers, put two numbers on the screen. Rather than an Excel spreadsheet with a laser pointer, or not even a laser pointer, you see? And people are like, I don't see anything. I can't even focus on it. This is the idea of the eye slide. What's the point? Am I hitting some nerves here? Mistake number two is not enough visuals. Lots of numbers, lots of stupid pie graphs and things like that. But humans don't relate to that stuff. We want visuals. Say it. Say it instead of throwing it up there. Or if you have to make a point, make it with just a simple picture where they will focus on you and you can talk. You can deliver a bigger punch with better visuals. There's endless sources of great visuals. iStock Photo and CompFight are great. You remember those little greedy people when they first just came out with PowerPoint? Like, and you go to people's websites now and there's hands shaking hands. It's like, no. Let's put some effort into it. To your point, we have to put some effort into it. We don't have to use cheesy stock photos. It's really not that fun working at a call center. Come on. Whatever visuals you use, remember that it's for that guy. That guy way in the back. If he can't see it, don't use it. Crap quality. My dear in the Maple Leafs jersey, can you stand up for me, please? Round of applause for the Leafs. Yeah! Both of you. Okay, let's do it together. Let's do it together. Can you read the sentence in the blue box, please? Video, thank you both. Video diary of an emerging artist. Real story, MTV, $2 million production promotional budget, was pitching a client regarding the VMAs, the Video Music Awards. They plan to do a video diary of an emerging artist. Imagine how that feels as a client sitting watching this going, well, yeah, you've got great attention to detail. You're even going to get my logo right on the screen. Because after we've read it 450 times, we don't even see that. I think you started to say video diary because you correct it automatically, right? We need to give the deck or the slides or something to somebody who's never seen it before. Or hire a proofreader. And then there is this spell check blessing that the computers have given us, which is killing us. This year's VMAs, possessive S. Wrong. But there's a lot of people who just rely on the computer more than we rely on basic grammar or our teaching. That, of course, that's got to be right, and it's not. Promos is apostrophed, and Mondays is apostrophed as possessive. Wrong. This is all in the same pitch, by the way. There, there, your, and your. Does anyone really know the difference? If the client does, you can't stand up there and say we have incredible attention to detail, because we've just made huge mistakes on a presentation worth a few million bucks. We don't have to bore them with childish videos. There are two shortcuts to great design. You can invest in it and put it into your share drive, and then everybody can use the various things. Or you can steal it. Everything's a remix.info will show you how to take a great presentation that you may have seen and pull it apart and do one just very similarly to it. Don't use crappy fonts. These are crappy fonts. Does anyone understand why Comic Sans might have been invented in the world? Stand up for me, my dear, please. Why in the world? Have you used Comic Sans ever in your life? Yay! Hell no! Round of applause! Yeah!
It was for moms for the first day they used their computer in 1986.
I think you're right. I think you're absolutely right. Because I used to use it when I was writing letters to my kids at camp. But I did have somebody say to me, I used it at university. I'm like, why? Because when they said 2 pages, I could get less words on 2 pages if I used Comic Sans. I'm like, okay, I gotcha. I feel you on this. If you Google beautiful fonts, you'll come up with things for free like Museo 500. It doesn't feel, it'll just feel different. For your audience, it'd be like, it's just clean, it's different, it's interesting, because it isn't something that's typical, right? 95% of our colleagues use PowerPoint, and it's been used for 22 years. You don't have to use PowerPoint or even InDesign or any of that stuff. You can go off-roading and tell stories. I'm going to show you how to do that in a second. Visual vomit. White space is a good thing. Spacing and alignment. This drove me nuts in the agency. They'd send you the slide at 11 o'clock at night and you had to put all of this type, or there was type that was supposed to be inside a square box that was kind of like a design, and there was crap falling through the back of the box and it looked horrible. Clients notice this. Keep it neat and tidy. Here are the 4 we've just looked at, but do you see that they're all black and white and there's a color palette that just kind of works together? They're all in the same family. The colors are all in the same family. The last design mistake is lack of preparation. When we talk about energy and effort being put into something, preparation is everything. Presentations suck because not enough time went into making them or rehearsing them. An outstanding presentation of 1 hour takes about 30 hours of prep. Now, that is 100% unrealistic in this world we're living in. Steve Jobs, anyone seen him ever in his lifetime present? Amazing. Made it feel like he was just standing having a conversation with you. Hours and hours and hours of rehearsal and preparation. If you want it to be spectacular, you have to invest the time. We have to be organized. When you set up, I always suggest to people, you're going to do a presentation, start with those big pads of paper. Stick them all over the walls. We're going to start with a visual of this, and then we're going to move to that, and we're going to sort of talk about this, and then we're going to do this, and then we're going to do this. And then you look at it and say, does that make sense? You can't really design a presentation on a computer. Because it doesn't work. You kind of have to have the big space and get it organized. 86% of top executives say this matter, but only 25% spend around 2 hours prepping. Design it, don't slap it together. So here is the recap of the things to avoid. Here is a quick recipe for a presentation. Step 1, A beautiful, clean cover page. True story again, MTV. Hey, can I borrow that deck that you presented last week to Twitter? Because we've got something really similar. Except that we forgot to remove Twitter. And they were presenting to Burger King. It happens, right? Give them a beautiful, impactful first page. Number two, objectives. If we see another pitch deck that says objectives in it, people's just eyes just glaze over and say, check out. I don't want to listen to you. I don't want the word objectives. Why are we here? What are we going to accomplish? Let's just speak English to each other. Number three, strategy. How are we going to get there? That's all it is. Number four, what are the ideas? Like, what are my options? Talk to me about what you're thinking about here. What this, that, or whatever. What do we recommend? Take a position. We would recommend you do this. Not just throw it all down on the table and say, buy something, anything. We don't really care. Just buy something. Take a position. It's important. Why does this approach make sense is your rationale. I know that this would work best for you, or I think this would work best for you because I understand your business and this and this and this and this is why I'm recommending that. Next steps. Where do we go from here? So some people don't even use slides. They just off-road go naked. Any opportunity to put a man, naked man in the presentation. Here's a great book. Nancy Duarte, Resonate. Fantastic book. Go on, Tiger. We need your presentations to never suck again. Give yourselves a huge round of applause. That's it. Could I have the other lovely lady in the NHL, yes, Toronto Maple Leafs shirt? Shannon, how many slides did I have? Take a wild guess. 50 or 15? 15? Okay, fantastic. Stay standing. David, how many slides did I have?
28.
28. Fantastic guess. This lovely lady here. Sally, stand up for me, please.
I would say 20.
20. Fantastic. You guys can sit. 86. So sometimes people say, I need you to contribute 20 slides to the presentation. Why do our slides end up all jammed up with millions of points and type running over each other? Because they don't let you have more than 20 slides. I did that in X number of minutes with 86 slides, and it hopefully never felt like 86 to anybody in the room. It was fun. It kept it moving. It was interesting. Yeah, it's graphic heavy. Who the hell cares? We live in a world where that's great. People want a presentation to entertain them. As soon as you start putting bullet points up, even if your bullet points fly in, I'm on my phone. I am on my phone. I am playing games. I don't know. We have so many ways to distract ourselves. You don't keep my attention. I'm on my phone. That's it. That's it for that. We can black the screen. It's completely done. If anybody wants a copy of that just for fun, you can throw a business card in there for me. Let's now get to this. In front of everybody, there's a little worksheet. It looks like a coloring sheet because I gave you crayons, and we always have to do things in a fun way on a Wednesday afternoon. Storytelling right now is a huge buzzword. Everybody talks about storytelling. These are underneath your coloring sheets. Or there's more on this table, number two. Why? Because emotion is the fast lane to the brain. When we feel something, we remember that thing. When we were kids, even before we were born in some cases, our parents read us stories. I remember being read Harry Potter, and then I remember thinking, I don't want to go to the damn film. I don't want to go to the movie. I had it all here. I had the whole movie in my head when they talked about Hagrid and they talked about Harry Potter. I saw them. I didn't want to go and have somebody else show me what they really looked like. When I was telling you the story of the boardroom and Ted and the presentation and also in McDonald's, could you see it? A little movie camera goes on in our head when we tell stories. It's the way humans connect with each other. We don't connect with each other this way. Even if we send pictures, it's still not like this. If you tell a story, funny, not funny, sad, self-deprecating, I don't care. You're offering a piece of your personal self to the audience, and they will remember you for it, always. This is how you structure a story, because you don't just stand up and say, I'm going to tell you a story. First of all, there has to be a reason. So the point here for me is, I want you to offer yourself in a story, a personal story. It can be about business, or it can be about your home life, your family, or something. But there has to be a point. If not, blah, blah, blah. It's very interesting, but don't waste my time. So the reason when Ted stood up and said, what the hell do you know about the Rogers brand? The reason I told him that story was what? Anyone want to stand up and answer the question? Why did I decide I was going to tell him about my 2 weeks of working at McDonald's? Personal, emotional, and I knew the facts. Absolutely, Carol, thank you. And one of the things that I was trying to make a point to Ted about is, we don't know shit about your brand until we walked in Roger's shoes, same as I had walked in Ronald McDonald's shoes. That was my pivotal point. You've got to have that as your anchor. Let's give you another example. In this business, you might have people who don't want to pay as much as you would like them to pay for things. Yes, please, stand up. Yell your question. Yes. Yes. 100%. I do. I don't think it was my story that derailed it. I think financially, the president wanted too much cash for that business, so that was the number one derail, and the guys with the blimp were probably the number two derail. I did have the selection committee come up to me afterwards and say, wow, first of all, good for you for being able to pivot on your feet that fast. And second of all, to say to Ted Rogers, you don't know anything about his brand, took some guts and humility. And rather than standing there saying, we're the best choice for you because we know, I decided we would learn. And I think he appreciated that. So I wouldn't have changed a thing. And the people who I was pitching with tended to agree with me. It's an opportunity to learn, it's an opportunity to read the room, and it's an opportunity to be empathetic. This guy had been, Tammy, one sec, darling. This guy had been through first the large, long pitch list for Rogers that had then gotten narrowed down, shortlisted to two agencies. He had sat through so many, we are the right agency for you, because we. Who the hell cares about the agency? This is about you, Ted. So I stood up and said, we don't know anything. We thought it was something, or we wouldn't have been on the damn short list, but we really don't know. But we want to learn, because we're going to learn it from the ground up. And I read in his face, I am so pissed off with agencies telling me that they know better and they are the best and they know this and they know that. I didn't want to be another one of those
people that would just be nah, nah, nah. Like the Snoopy and Charlie Brown teacher, nah, nah, nah. I would feel like that's exactly what he would hear. So I don't. I handed it out to him on a silver platter and said, I don't know, but I want your business and I'm committed and we're going to learn together. And I don't think any of the other agencies said, gee, we want to put our people on your trucks. But it was good. I hope I answered your question. Was it my original pitch? Can you just speak that into the, thank you for being Vanna.
Was that your original pitch to admit that you knew nothing about the company, or is that what you pivoted into?
That's what I pivoted into because I had no idea.
What was your original?
Oh, I had slides that were like hellishly boring, even though we had the creative department there for 3 nights working nonstop, drinking coffee and doing whatever else they did.
So it was all about the agency again?
Of course.
Okay.
We've worked on this brand, we've worked on that retail, we know more, blah, blah, blah. Some wonderful person, because we flew in one of these great AV people so that we didn't have to worry about knowing how to advance slides and stuff. I just said black the slide, and I went to the story. And I didn't go there, because the guy didn't want to hear about the chest pounding that was going on by the agencies who were pitching his business. And that's what really it felt like, was I'm trying to sell you something, and we're great, and we're great, and we're great, and we're great. Like, who the hell cares? What I want to hear is what the hell you're going to do for me. And that was the point. Here's the sheet. Let's walk through it really quickly, because the sheet is important because I would like you to write a story for me. It's kind of like driving. You can sit and somebody can tell you, this is how you drive a car. You have no idea how to drive a car until you get behind the wheel. So we're going to write a story. Number one, set the scene. Any story you ever read gives you some kind of a layout of, it was a lovely day in the forest when Red Riding Hood went for a walk. Whatever it is. So in my case, I'd put it in red. It was my first day of work at Vickers and Benson. Now this is a guideline. Don't get hung up. My point is, don't just stand up there and start pontificating. You do have to put a few minutes of thought behind the story that you might want to use. Point number two. Introduce the characters. In my case, it was me. I was going to work. It was my first day at Vickers and Benson. How was I feeling? Number three, begin the journey. I arrived at reception. Had my suit on, I was all ready. I say, I can't wait to get started. Number four, the obstacle. Who was my obstacle? Going to you. Who was my what was my obstacle? Good morning, Marilyn. Joan. Joan was the obstacle. Every story has an obstacle. Something, an issue that we have to get around that makes it interesting. Number five, to overcome the obstacle. The only thing I could do with Joan was to say, okay, I'm not getting past you. I guess I better do what I'm being told to do, which is go up to McDonald's for the next 2 weeks. Go to six. Now you can resolve the story. So up the street I walked, I had my apron, I had my button. Number seven. Here's the point. Those 2 weeks at McDonald's were the toughest 2 weeks of my life. But you know what? I walked in Ronald's shoes and I learned the brand from the ground up, literally, from lying in front of the fry machine. That's why I'm telling you the story, Ted. You can, number eight, you can ask if you want. You can say, has anyone had something similar like this happened to them in their lives? It's like, oh yeah, God, I remember the first day I worked at KFC. Oh. Involve the audience. Number nine, you restate the point. So don't ever let anyone tell you that they're going to work on your brand and make a difference to your business unless they truly have walked a mile in your shoes. Within the context of you, body language is critical. You
are the most important part of the presentation, not what's up here. I walk. I reach under the table for the apron and the button.
I do voices like Joan.
I'm a clown. Maybe people don't feel comfortable with that. Maybe you feel comfortable doing other things. But body language and voice intonation helps with your story. You can create suspense. You can create all different kinds of emotions just simply through your body, your hands, and your voice. So whenever you're making a presentation or telling a story, within whatever you feel comfortable with, make sure you think about that. People get nervous when they present, so they talk really fast, and they just want to get through the slides so they can damn well sit down so I don't have to think about it anymore. But when you go slowly, it feels to you like 4 hours. It's only about 15 or 20 seconds to your audience, and they appreciate it. I would like you to write a story. Here's an example. You need to come up with, in your mind, what's the point if you're sitting in front of a client? What is the point you're trying to make with the client? Here's an example. Guy in one of these sessions said, I was trying to make the point you get what you pay for. Big headline. You think of it as a billboard kind of headline. Like, you don't know my brand until you've walked a mile in my shoes. You can think of that as a big headline. So this guy wanted to prove to a client, you get what you pay for. Here's his little story. I was a brand new father, and the baby came early. And my wife was at the hospital, and we had pretty much everything all ready to go. The nursery was painted, the little mobiles were ringing, the baby hangers were there, the baby play suits and onesies and everything, it was done. But we didn't have the diapers. So I had to leave my wife at the hospital while I went and got the diapers. I got the most incredible deal on the diapers. I got like 1,000 diapers for $100. I had diapers everywhere in the nursery, stacked on the diaper change paper, inside the closet, underneath the crib. We were ready. Wife brought the baby home. Within the amount of hours it normally takes, the baby had its first poo. Everywhere. The diapers were horrible. I was the worst father on the planet because I didn't buy Pampers. And I learned the hard way that in the world of diapers, as in the world of most everything else, you get what you pay. Here was Mr. Self-Deprecating explaining, now I know he's a dad, he's had a newborn baby, he's tried really hard to figure out the diapers for the newborn baby, it was a complete disaster, but he proved his point. And people in the audience would be like, hey, I like this guy. He's a father, has a kid, he messed up on the diapers, he was willing to share that. And it sort of brought his point home of, you get what you pay for, if you're buying shitty diapers, you're gonna have a shitty outcome. Absolutely, pun intended. So if you can think, and we'll put on some nice little music, for 5 minutes about a story. I'd like it to be a story that you could tell in a business situation. In other words, usable. We will stay up all night, we will go to any ends of the earth to make sure that you are delighted with the end result, or whatever your point is, I'd like you to write your story. Now, do you then need to stand up and present your story with your sheet? No, but the idea is simply just to follow the little structure so you kind of get the idea of, once you've thought it through with the 9 points, you'll be able to stand up and deliver it, no problem, no notes. I had a question once from a client that said, no problem, you can just make this up, right? This has to be real, and this has to be from your heart, and this has to have actually happened to you. Because you know what? We can tell. We can tell if you're trying to put one over on us. There is something that changes in you when you deliver a story that's happened to you, that's emotional to you in some way. Okay?
Could we grab some music? Just a little bit of background music. I'll give you 5 minutes and I'll walk around and help anybody who needs to help. Are there any questions at all around this that doesn't seem... Okay. And be prepared. Yes, we're going to hear your stories afterwards. Please. If you want to talk with your team, feel free to talk with your team. If you need inspiration, throw your hand up. I'll help you if I can. Okay? I'm going to actually ask you to stand on the stage. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, then I'm not going to ask you to stand on the stage. I'm just going to ask you to stand wherever you're comfortable. Could we have a huge round of applause for Ken? Here's what I would like to understand first, and then I'm going to sit down and you're going to tell your story. What is the point, the headline that you're trying to make?
Everything's possible.
Beautiful. Another round of applause. You have the floor.
So this goes back to when I first started in this business. I was maybe 6 months into the business and I was struggling hard. I wanted to get into the Toronto Star. Three phone calls and finally this lady gives me an appointment. It's Friday morning at 10 o'clock in the morning and I'm in to see her. The Leafs had just won game 6 against St. Louis and they're going into game 7. And if everybody remembers way back, the Toronto Sun used to always have placards that they would hand out before the games in the stands. So all the people were waving these Toronto Sun placards. They'd be on TV all the time. 10 o'clock in the morning, I'm sitting in my client's office Friday morning. And she says, can you do a rush order for me? And I'm like, for what? She goes, hand fans. I'm like, sure. How many do you need? She goes, I need 10,000 hand fans. Okay, when do you need them for? I need them for tomorrow at noon, Saturday at noon. Now, a little bit of background. I come from the printing industry. I'd been in this industry in the promo business for only 6 months, and I'm like, I know a company that does hand fans, but they're out of Montreal. We might be able to do Air Canada cargo to get them here by tomorrow, but let me just call my boss and see if this is even possible. And I call Howie, and Howie says to me, not a chance. Well, I'm young and naive, and I'm sitting in front of this client, and I really want to impress her, and I want to tell her that I can do this because it's, you know, big deal for me. I said, you know what? I think we can do this. Let me make some phone calls. You get working on the art, and we'll work to get it done. One color, one side, right? She goes, no, two colors, two sides. I'm like, okay, now you're really throwing things at me. I leave and I call Mini Media, and I'm talking to Rajan, and I'm like, can we do this? How do we do this? And actually, I think it was Francine, but she goes, well, we'd have to do this, and we'd have to do that, and we'd have to have the art in here by 1:30, 2 o'clock the latest. I'm like, okay, call the client, art by 2. Long and short of it, the art doesn't get there at 2. The art doesn't get there at 3. Now we can't get it done. Said, I got one more phone call to make. Called a buddy of mine at a printing company, and I said, you got time on your press this afternoon or tonight? He's like, sure, what do you need? And I told him. I said, well, just do die cuts or guillotine cuts. You can't do a custom die cut, but we can do square cuts. And I went out and I bought 10,000 tongue depressors. I bought a dozen heavy-duty staplers and 25,000 staples. I got 10 of my friends that I offered them $100 each to show up the next morning. We showed up at the printing plant and we stood there and we stapled tongue depressors to guillotine cut cardboard stock. We packaged them up. At noon, we delivered them down to the Maple Leaf Gardens. And again, the moral of the story is anything's possible. So when you ask me if I can do something, I'm not gonna give up on you until I know it cannot be done.
Stay up there for me, please, Ken. I'll take your mic for a second. Carol, stand up for me, please. What did you love about this story?
Passionate, honest, and anything's possible.
Absolutely. Ted, you'll always be Ted to me. Stand up for me, please. Ted, what did you love about this story?
That it was very personal, and that, yes, anything is possible, and that's the important message and it came across clear.
Fantastic. Scott, what did you love about this story? Stand up for me, please.
I loved that it involved the Maple Leafs, for one, and it brought a memory back of going to Maple Leaf Gardens as well. So,
another huge round of applause. Thank you so much.
By the way, when I was going through mini media, my margins were only like 28%. When I went through the printing company, it became 62%.
That a boy! We will always remember Ken. In your mind, did you see? I could see the tongue depressors and the people with the staplers making it happen. You're a table of three. Who would like to stand up and present a story here?
The boss.
Yeah. The boss. All right, boss. Come on up. Let's give the boss a huge round of applause, please. Only if you want. If found that once you've written it down and followed the steps, you don't necessarily need it, but if you want it, there you go. So what is the point? What's the big headline that we should sort of look for as you tell us your story?
The point is actually kind of similar to Ken's, and
okay.
It's just go that extra mile for, go the extra mile.
Okay, perfect. If you could move the mic up a little closer to your mouth, great,
okay.
And you have the floor.
All right, so we were in the thick of the busy fall season, selling season in the GTA. I was pretty pumped because I just landed a big deal. I was on cloud nine all week long. Got the order, got it processed, sent it into the manufacturer, and we did have a kind of tight deadline, not nearly as tight as Ken's, but you know, definitely doable. Until one day, getting a call from the company that, hey, we ran into some issues with supply, and we're gonna miss your deadline. Well, you know, nobody likes to miss a deadline, especially when there's an event on the other end where our customer had to get it to their customer at a specific time. Well, a few calls, pulled a few strings. You know, we had to fly some product in to make sure it kind of got there on time, but we were still really pushed to get it. We weren't able to ship it. We're located in Kitchener, so we're, you know, an hour west of here. Our client was in Toronto, and their client was in the GTA, and they had to get it, you know, on a Friday afternoon. The product arrived to us on a Friday morning, and loaded up my car, called the rep who I was dealing with. We actually met halfway at the Mohawk Raceway parking lot, emptied it from my car into his car. He then drove directly there, right to his client, and actually was able to deliver the product there on time.
Woo! What do we love? Tammy, what did you love about the story?
Again, that it was honest and believable and well told.
Thank you. David, what did you love about the story? Thank you.
I think it was nice to see that he was very proud of what he had done. So
you could tell that, couldn't
yeah.
you? Just even, it's like you sort of relive it when you're telling the story. You could feel him feeling like, I did this.
Exactly.
Fantastic. My dear, what did you love about the story?
I guess just echoing what both of you said, it was very genuine and honest, and that showed that he was proud of what he did.
Absolutely, willing to go to any lengths whatsoever. Thank you for sharing. Yes, you're scratching your nose.
Yeah.
Who would like to tell their story here, Team 10?
Paul's doing it.
Paul's doing it. Is Paul doing it?
Yeah, he organized the event. I think he should tell his story.
Guess what, you just got voluntold. Come on up. Big round of applause for Paul. What's your headline, Paul, that
so,
we should be looking for?
I like to talk about how I can be an invaluable asset at no charge to my customers.
Come a little closer with the mic.
Sorry, thank you.
Thank you.
I had a customer who tried going to Leslie Ashby, but she turned them down. So they came to me, of course. Basically, I had a customer who was kind of down on their luck, and they were trying to earn a new client, and they were trying to differentiate themselves. and came to me for some answers. And I said, why don't you take me along on the sales call and see what I can do, maybe make a difference. So he decided, you know, it's kind of weird, but sure. So we sat down, we made a plan as to what the customer's looking for and if they had any upcoming events that we could service them and come up with some ideas. And we found out that they had an event where they're going to the Formula One races in Montreal, and they wanted to look really good both during the day and at night. So I put together a clothing presentation specifically for this, for our first meeting, and said, you know, we're going to pitch some Cutter & Buck product. It's new, upcoming, and nobody else is probably pitching it yet. So this is how we're going to differentiate ourselves. So we went and we showed up at the client's office, and they weren't there. They weren't there. They were kind of brushed off the customer. So we called them on the cell phone, said, well, where are you? He's like, well, I'm at home. So we decided, can we come to your house and present to you? And he's like, you do that? I'm like, sure. So we got in the car, packed the stuff back up, drove to the customer's house, pitched in his kitchen with his wife coming down in her robe by accident, not realizing people were there. And we were able to put together a very short but effective presentation where I was knowledgeable about the product, showed value to that client that Dave, who I was working with, had the respect of the supplier reps to come with him, and it really added value to the presentation. We ended up selling that customer into, it was close to a $10,000 sale by the end of the presentation, which was about 40 minutes later. And once again, I was just back in that guy's kitchen last week, actually presenting again. So I was a cost-free resource to you, Mr. Distributor, and I can be there for you to help you make a difference, and it's free.
Stay up there for me, Paul. All right. What did you love about Paul's presentation?
I love the sincerity in his voice and how he presented, and it was to the heart.
Fancy.
Really good looking. Yeah.
Good. I want to hear your story, absolutely. What did you love about Paul's presentation?
You're
going to stand up for me right here.
Sorry. I really loved his excitement about the story and his own personal connection, obviously, to the story, and even his body language as he told it.
I noticed that, too. His wife was coming down the stairs in her... You saw it, right? Now, it's harder when you've got a handheld mic. Not necessarily visualizing the, you know, opening the kimono situation, but the idea that he was just very naturally sort of creating the visuals, yeah? When I'm like picking up the apron or the button or the whatever, that just helps us to really instill it in our brains. Round of applause. Good for you. Great, come on up. If you want your paper with you, that's great. But you notice how you don't really need it. Once you've thought it through and it really happened to you, you don't need your notes. If you're making it up, no possible way. But we're not doing that. Huge round of applause. Yeah. What's the headline, my dear? What's the point? It doesn't have to be elegant, but what are you trying to express here?
Do whatever you can do to make your customer happy, even when you think you can't.
Okay, fantastic. You have the floor.
And this story is so new, it's less than 24 hours new.
Oh,
it's so new that this story, I've been in the business for 23 years, it's going up on the top shelf of all my experiences in the industry as a negative to a huge positive. So, and one of our great suppliers, Debco, made it happen. So Monday evening, I'm sitting at my son's soccer practice on this very cold aluminum bench. And it's about 6:30 and I get an email from my client. And I read it. And long story short, the product that she received, it's not good. It's not good at all. I won't get into the details of it, but the product wasn't good. and the packaging wasn't good. And there was no way, she was trying, but there was no way she could hand this out to her, the recipient that she was gonna hand it out to. When's your event? It's Wednesday at noon. Okay, tomorrow's Tuesday. What am I gonna do? Okay, can you send me a picture? Yeah, I got a picture. I can't really grab, I have to come there. So I drove there and I wasn't able to get to her until noon yesterday. I get there, but she wasn't there. I'll leave the box for you at the front. I pick the box up, I look at it, I'm like, it's unacceptable, absolutely unacceptable. And I let Ashley at Debco know that I'm coming with this box and we need to come up with a solution. Drove, even though I thought that maybe we couldn't do anything, but there was no option at all. I had to do something for this person. This person, even though this was a very small dollar value order, was huge because this person opened me up to so many people in this company. And actually, this was the first imprinted product order that this client ordered from me. So the first one was absolutely terrible. Long story short, get to Debco, sit down with Ashley. She's thinking of a solution with the existing product. Can we make it happen? It's already 1:45. And she says, let me go check. I said, let me get look at your catalog. I'll look at the catalog of going through things. Maybe there's something I can find as a substitute, potentially. She comes back. Yeah, we can't use that existing product. And I'm like, okay, what about this one? It's 2:15 now. Can we do it? I think so, maybe. Let me check. Can you get the art? No, I can't. Can you? Anyways, she did it. She got the order printed. It was done. And it was there for me to pick up this morning, just after 9:30. I got there, but the great challenge was the packaging. They package a lot of their products in these little foam bags right now, and the client just didn't like that. So yesterday, which is one of the other characters in the story, was this packaging guy. His name was Joel. He found me this awesome Ziploc bag. So here I am, when I picked up the product from Debco, I drove over this morning at 11 o'clock, and there I am in my car, packaging, repackaging these things, taking them and putting stickers on and putting them in to try to meet this 12 noon deadline to get this product to the client, put it in there, put it beautiful, everything went well. And the best thing was, which I don't have my phone up for me, was the message from the client afterwards. She says, I just handed these things out and everybody loves them. And so when you think you can't do it and you need to make your customer happy, don't give up. Do whatever you can do to make your customer, even when you think you can't. That's the point. And thank you, Debco.
Stay up there for me for a second, my dear. I just want to hear a couple of comments. Going to you, Scott. What did you love?
The sincerity, again, is dealing with the client and making it happen. It's you can't deal with the client and not get this sort of appreciation when you don't do that. So
I could picture him in the car with the Ziploc bags, right? What did you love about this?
Extremely relatable. I think we've all been in that situation. So to hear you pulled it off, it's like one for the team.
Yeah, absolutely. Fantastic. Another round of applause. Ken, could you stand up for me, please? What was Ken's story? Look at Ken. What was Ken's story?
Toronto Sun.
And how many stories? Thanks, my dear, you can sit down. How many stories did we hear in between? And it sticks.
Four.
Exactly, it sticks. That's the point. If you could pick up here's what I'd like you to do. The blue card. The blue card's on your table. If everybody get a blue card in front of you, then I'm gonna wrap it up for you because I promised I would get you done by 4:30.
The blue card, side number one. I would like you to write down your aha moment.
Jay has an aha every week that she publishes a book she's published on aha moments.
There you go. So I should give you credit. Circle aha. C, copyright. Really? An aha moment journal. How great is that? Did you write this?
Uh-huh.
It's yours. I'll sign it for you.
Will you sign it for me? I'm so excited. So we need one of these on your blue card. God bless you. We didn't even talk about this beforehand. It's fantastic. It can be anything from I love the coloring sheet to the gut. What does your gut tell you was your aha moment? Where did the light bulb go on for you today during the last hour and a half we've been chatting? What was that? When you have that down, turn it over. And on the other side of that card, I'd like you to say, finish this sentence. It would be a missed opportunity if we didn't. Didn't what? Missed opportunity if we didn't what? Dot, dot, dot. It would be a missed opportunity if we didn't what? If you have an aha moment, I really would love to hear yours.
Strive.
Okay, one word.
Strive.
Strive. Beautiful. This is like a lovely wrap-up word. This is deep, the word strive. Jay, what did you have as your aha moment? I'm asking the queen of the ahas. Stand up for me, please.
The queen of the ahas. Resonance. The stories have to resonate from the heart and to be relevant to people.
Absolutely. Thank you. One more aha moment. Yes, my dear. Let's stand up with the mic.
Create a picture in the mind of the people you're telling your story to.
Absolutely.
You actually created a picture of Ted, and I actually saw him with like a plaid jacket on, and like the way you did it and the way he stood up, and you just created that in my mind.
And you know what? It's easy to do. You don't have to try. You have to basically describe what you're seeing. So as you're telling the story, it's running in your brain like a movie. Just describe the movie to your audience. That's all you have to do. They'll see a different movie. Not everybody had Ted in a plaid jacket. Doesn't matter. Everybody's movie's a little different, which is why I never wanted to go to Harry Potter, because I'm like, no, you're going to wreck it for me, because I have an image of this. Okay, it would be a missed opportunity if we didn't.
Didn't.
Stand up and tell us what your missed opportunity might be.
If we didn't improve our storytelling by the great ideas we've learned.
Great, thank you. I'll take one more and then we'll give ourselves a round of applause. Oh, there's a heart. It's so lovely. But you've got a heart, so it's maybe speak from the heart is what, yeah, exactly. I'm coming here, my dear. It would be a missed opportunity if we didn't, first of all, stand up for me.
Try to relate to our customers or clients, whoever we're telling the story to.
Absolutely. That's it for me. The Play-Doh is yours. The candy bags are yours. I am happy to turn this back over if we would like to say goodbye or whatever is happening after here or business or whatever. Give yourselves a huge round of applause.